Well, hello, everyone. I'd like to welcome you. My name is Lisa Honaker. I'm the Dean of the School of Arts and Humanities, and I'm here to introduce this event and the artists who will be having a conversation. I'm going to start by sharing brief bios and then give a little context for the conversation you're about to witness. Please know that you can ask questions. In fact, as soon as you have questions while the folks are talking, please feel free to put them in the chat, but they will not be asked until the end of the conversation. So with that, I begin. And I begin by introducing our own Wendel A. White, who was awarded a BFA in photography from the School of Visual Arts in New York, and an MFA in photography from the University of Texas at Austin. White taught photography at the School of Visual Arts, New York, the Cooper Union for the Advancement of Science and Art, New York, the International Center for Photography, New York, Rochester Institute of Technology, and he is currently the Distinguished Professor of Art at Stockton University. His work has received numerous awards and fellowships and is represented in museum and corporate collections across the US. Our other artist, Casey Rebell, received her BA from Smith College in 1995 and her MFA from Hunter College in 2002. She is an associate clinical professor of art at Fordham University, where she teaches a range of courses and curates exhibitions for the university galleries. Her work has been shown nationally and abroad, and she has been the recipient of grants and fellowships from the New Jersey State Council on the Arts, Tulane University's New Orleans Center for the Gulf South Monroe Fellowship, 2019, the Wharf Hall Foundation through a residency in Parsonola, the Smithsonian Institution, and the New Jersey State Council for the Humanities. She resides in Milford, New Jersey, and New Orleans. And now about the exhibit, The Question the Answer Hides. I love this exhibit title, by the way, and the way in which it asks the viewer to discover the question and to think through the implications. That's how I read the title. We step back from the artist's work centered on Red Summer, 1919, the worst year for white on black violence in US history, to step back from what they see to largely ordinary or seemingly unremarkable locations whose history of violence may now register through the historical context provided by newspaper clippings to account for that violence, often in racist terms of their own, or through Rubel's anti-portraiture, erasing historic white personages from photos in which they appear, leaving only a ghostly outline of them in their place. In both artists' work, the context changes the viewer's position and what she sees, asking her to confront this historical violence and the ways in which it has been erased and or eluded. We are made to consider the ways in which racial violence has shaped our perceptions and experience of the ordinary. Both Wendel White and Casey Ruble have made this sort of recovery and recontextualization of facts and history the center of their artistic practice. Professor White's manifest photos, in addition to the Red Summer collection, the manifest photos that include objects like a Klan hood, a lock of Frederick Douglass's hair, a high school class ring. He photographs these objects against a solid black background, divorcing them from their usual context to make the viewer consider them anew. And in Will of the People, Professor Rubel uses newspaper clippings to contextualize her own monochromatic works, constructed, as she says, from a handmade reflective silver paper that has been metal dried to produce subtle stains and splotches on the surface. The size, color, and weathered texture of the pieces make them look somewhat like headstones, and their reflectivity gives them a ghostliness that alludes to the tension between our society's amnesia and the remembrance of past violent episodes. The sculptural aspect of the works positions them in an odd spatial netherworld between illusion and three-dimensional reality, suggesting that what we think we see may not always align with what is actually there. And these, this last bit was all from Casey Rebell's own talk about her work. Both White and Ruble then, in, again, Casey Rebell's words, offer a portrait of America viewed through the lens of our history of violence and suggest that although the present may be unmoored from the past, it will never become perfectly free from it. And with that, I welcome you to what promises to be an instructive and compelling conversation between Casey Ruble and Wendel White about their work. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. Thanks so much. And I want to, first of all, say thank you to Dean Honaker for making that wonderful introduction, to Denise McGarvey, who is the coordinator of the Stockton Art Gallery, and for all of her efforts to put together the exhibition. And she will be here monitoring the Q&A portion for us. And when we get to the end of our conversation, we will hopefully see if there are any questions that have been sparked in the by the participants that we can also address as we go along. This is really intended to be a conversation. And so what we both are going to do is take just a couple of minutes to provide a little context. And so I'm going to share two of my images, so that especially for those of you who obviously won't be able to make it here to see the exhibition, you'll at least see one or two, you'll see one image from each of the two projects that are on display. And I'll take that opportunity to give you a little bit of background from my artist statements. And then we'll switch and Casey will do something similar by way of introduction. So we'll take a few minutes for that, but then we have questions in a sense for each other so that we can begin the conversation. And primarily we hope to spend most of our time in that conversation today. In the one of the two projects that I have posted, in participating in the exhibition is Schools for the Colored. And the Schools for the Colored project is a series of architectural landscapes of historically African-American schools. And a lot of the appearance of it is drawn from a thinking about a literary reference by W.E.B. Du Bois in his book, The Souls of Black Folk. He describes an early school experience. "I was different from the others, or like mayhap, in heart and life and longing, but shut out from their world by a vast veil." And so I began making these images based on that literary reference. Schools for the Colored is a portfolio, an extension of the photographic work and social concepts in the project Small Towns, Black Lives, in that it is a continuation of my journey through the African-American landscape. I began making photographs of historically African-American schools during the very first weeks of the Small Towns, Black Lives project more than 25 years ago. In this project, I began to pay attention to the many structures and sites, also making photographs of places where buildings once stood that operated as segregated schools. The photographs depict buildings and the surrounding landscapes that were associated with the system of racially segregated schools established at the southern boundaries of the northern United States. This area, sometimes referred to as the Up South, encompasses the northern free states that bordered the slave states. Schools for the Colored is a representation of the duality of racial distinction within American culture. The veil, the digital imaging technique of obscuring the landscape surrounding the schools, is a visual representation of the W.E.B. Du Bois literary metaphor of the veil as a social barrier. Some of the images depict sites where the where the original structure is no longer present. As a placeholder, I have inserted silhouettes of the original building or what I imagine the appearance of the building. The architecture and geography of America's educational apartheid in the form of a system of, quote, colored schools within the landscape of Southern New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana, and Illinois is the central concern of this project. The other images and the images for which we, Casey and I, have shared a specific interest are from the project Red Summer. The Red Summer portfolio represents the stories of various landscapes and the locations in the American landscape where racial violence, often characterized as race wars at the time, erupted between 1917 and 1923. These years of conflict reveal several aspects of racial anxiety that inform our contemporary experience, including, though not limited to, racism, fear of violent Black revolt, lynching, poverty, mass incarceration, and competition for employment. The term Red Summer was first used by James Weldon Johnson to describe the violent attacks against Black communities during 1919. The conceptualization of the veil, as expressed by Du Bois, once again, has been a metaphor for the representation of race within my work for several decades, particularly in the two projects known as Schools for the Colored and Red Summer. The newspaper, in its role as a public record, commentary, and historical archive, is also a veil of information through which most of the country, as well as many in the international community, understood and misunderstood these events. And so I'm going to leave it at that and turn this over to Casey.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Wendel. And you know, my many thanks to both Denise and Lisa and everybody at the Stockton University Art Galleries. It's been really a pleasure working with you, and I'm excited to have my work up there. So I'm just going to go ahead and share my screen. So the series that I'm going to talk mostly about today is my Red Summer series. And this series, you know, again, as Wendel said, is where our interests sort of overlap the most. But this series actually grew out of an earlier series that I have been working on and is still in progress, which is We the People. And I apologize for the poor quality of this image. But it gives you a sense of what the We the People works look like. So basically these works are large scale. This one's about 3 by 4 feet, collages made of handmade silver paper that's reflective. And each depicts a site, a present day version of the site where a race riot had broken out. So I'm actually go all the way back to, you know, the early 1800s in this particular series, you know, and looking at where these race wars occurred all the way up through the civil rights period and after that. So in the course of doing research on these riots or race wars, I discovered that 1919, as Wendel said, was the deadliest year of white on Black violence in American history. And so when I was invited in 2016 to, I was nominated to apply for a Smithsonian Artist Research Fellowship. I decided to focus specifically on the year of 1919. And then do it through looking at the collection of the National Portrait Gallery in Washington, DC. So my idea was to look at the year 1919, the works in the collection that were produced in 1919. So the gallery, the National Portrait Gallery was actually, planning began on it coincidentally also in 1919. And the museum finally ended up opening in 1968, which of course was another year of deadly riots in this country. But from the beginning, the National Portrait Gallery's mission was to, display and acquire portraits of men and women who had made significant contributions to the history, development, and culture of the people of the United States. And so I was like, all right, I'm gonna look at, you know, who is being depicted? Like, who are these people who are making these significant contributions? And when I looked at the year 1919 and all of the works that were made then, which included 47 different works, all of them were white. So based on this fact, it gave me the idea to sort of say, all right, what would happen if I re-rendered each of those works from the collection from 1919, but with the sitter removed? So it would be this way, I thought, of sort of wiping the sitter away and looking at the literal background of that tumultuous year. So I'm just gonna go through and a few of the pieces for this. This one is actually a portrait of Frank Leon Polk, who is a diplomat in his office. This is the painter, American painter, John Ferguson Weir. And just to give you a little bit of insight on how I'm actually creating the pieces, I would start by painting in everything that was surrounding the sitter. And then after that was done, I would go in and try to meticulously recreate what I thought was being hidden by the sitter. So in this case, it's like essentially all of the back side of that chair. And when I would go back in and try to fill in that blank space, I would let the paintbrush just barely go back over the background that I had already painted. And that's what gives you the sort of ghostly outline of the figure. This is a re-rendering of a photograph of filmmaker Cecil B. DeMille. This is the actress Gloria Swanson. It's a re-rendering of a studio portrait of her. And in the original, her head is sort of poking out from this welter of African animal prints. And I see a real irony in this particular painting because Swanson, you know, sort of used, you know, feathers and animal prints as a way of exoticizing herself. You know, and so you have this sort of appropriation of, you know, of a traditionally African kind of set of visuals to, you know, sort of, it almost ends up reinforcing her whiteness. This is a painting of Henry White in his elaborate office. In all of these, when the piece was framed, I included the frame in re-rendering to sort of call attention to the fact that they're objects. This is a painting of the signing of the Treaty of Versailles in the Hall of Mirrors. John Joseph Pershing was a witness to the signing of the treaty. Anyhow, I'm glad to be back. That gives you enough of a sense. I didn't get quite through all of them, but it gives you enough of a sense of what the series is about. So I think we can move into questions for each other, Wendell, if you're ready.
Absolutely.
Do you mind if I start with a question?
Sure, absolutely.
All right, so one.
We didn't decide who was gonna start.
You know, so there's the famous William Faulkner quote, the past is never dead, in fact, it's not even past. Mm-hmm. And I think about that a lot. You know, one of the things that we discovered when we first met each other and happened to both be working on these depictions of riots is that we had been to a lot of the same places to photograph them and make the work subsequently. And one of the things that that I really notice when I go to a lot of these places is that there's no evidence of that past. It just looks like a banal street corner or an empty parking lot or, you know, a touristy boutique shop. Occasionally there's a plaque that talks about what happened at that place, but usually not in my experience. And so, you know, I feel like with your works, your Red Summer works, without the addition of the newspaper articles that accompany those photographs, your photographs would similarly seem like the past is the past, you know, and that history has been forgotten. But then you have the newspaper articles that are, you know, cluing you into what's happened in the past. And, you know, reading a lot of the newspaper articles that came out right after the January 6th assault on our Capitol this year, I noticed that a lot of the reporting from that is very similar to the kinds of like breathless sort of reporting that happens in the articles that you pair with the sites. So in that way, you know, all of these things feel very present, very much of the present, and also very much of the past. So I was just wondering what you make of Faulkner's quote, and if you're thinking about that when you visit these sites or when you produce the works back in your studio.
Yeah, I absolutely, that has been a significant experience and motivation. I wanted to tie both things together, and in terms of what it's been like to do the work, but at the same time, what the kind of experience is that I'm trying to craft as I'm working on putting the pieces together. And in addition to that, I've been, you know, particularly drawn to a series of events and the way in which that series of events plays out, not just, and I think it's important that you sort of reference January 6th, because, you know, for me, going further back a little bit and coming forward a bit, there's an ongoing repetition in this set of events. And I think that if we start at the rupture of the Civil War, about 40 to 50 years later, we get to 1919, 50 years later. And then about 50 years later, we get to the Civil Rights era. And then about 50 years later, we're about where we are today. And each of these, and not to sort of oversimplify it, but it's as if in the experience of moving along historically and chronologically in the American landscape and culture and narrative, that what happens is we begin to experience this sense of loss, I think, that begins to emerge. Well, for some of us, for some folks, a sense of loss begins to emerge as the society has made various attempts at racial reconciliation and reunion. I'm always drawn to David Blythe's book, The Race and Reunion, about the way in which that post-Civil War era, which lands in the around the World War I in particular, is a really significant one. And all of those feel like moments in which we continually sort of pull back and re-reference. And yet at the same time, it seems as though it's so important to forget. It's almost a trauma that happens to the American, you know, populace. And in the body politic, so to speak, we wind up using forgetting as a sort of salve or as a kind of solution to a set of problems that are difficult and an unwillingness to really grapple with those difficult problems. Just before we started, we were sort of talking to you about the possibility, about how cold it was there and, you know, that change in weather. And I thought about that and this question that you have about the past is never dead, in that I was watching a news program last night that covered the history of these cold weather events in 1989, and about every 10 years after that, they have run into these problems of the cold weather coming in and the whole energy grid, you know, sort of seizing up because it's not weatherized. And from 1989 forward, various experts have come in and said, you know, you got to fix this you know, grid, and they sort of say, okay, but it's too difficult, we're going to forget it, we're going to move forward, and then it happens again, and it's happening. Next experience that we're grappling with when we talk about race and social justice and violence and violent upheaval in the United States and in the way it plays out in the landscape. And so what was remarkable for me as I traveled, and I've made note of this sometimes, is the degree to which these sites have been typically marked. There was two overall that had been marked when I was traveling. I have been told by people that a third site that I visited has now got a marker that describes the events as they happened. And of course, in 2019, since then, there's been particular interest in the centennial of these events. But I am, you know, fairly, I always was fairly surprised at how little emphasis there had been, you know, over the past century of something that broke out all over the United States, and all the hundreds, if not thousands, of deaths that occurred as a result of the violence, and it just seemed to vanish from our consciousness. And I think that that's that in and of itself is kind of a remarkable mechanism.
Yeah, it makes
me. I've been thinking, go ahead.
What you're saying sort of reminds me of, you know, there was actually a reunion for, I think 50 years after Gettysburg,
right.
Where they invited, you know, veterans of the Civil War for, again, like a reunion, and yet they didn't include any African-American soldiers. You know, the only African-American presence was to basically produce this quote-unquote reunion. So it's like another form of sort of erasure wrapped up in this idea of a remembrance.
Right. And in particular for that one, it was at the time the most expensive, elaborate event that the federal government had ever put on, because every veteran, no matter where in the United States, had all their expenses paid to travel to Gettysburg, you know, for that. So it wasn't just like, oh, let's all get together. This was a big planned event with a huge investment of money in order to create a kind of reconciliation between two primarily white factions of the American population, the Northern and Southern population, to say, wait a second, at least we have this in common, and we need to, you know, make sure that we resolve our differences and sort of go forward and find ways to go forward in opposition to growing Black agency within the American landscape.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And of course, that was, you know, also, you know, layering, another layer of that is Woodrow Wilson, and there are a number of different, you know, pieces. And I noticed looking through the catalog for the artist book, really, that is associated with the Red Summer Project for you, and has all of the images that are part of the exhibition that I got a chance to see. One of the things that's remarkable is, you know, certainly how many times Woodrow Wilson's name, you know, shows up out. I should have counted, but am I right thinking that he's the most present figure in all of the portraits?
Yes, definitely, by quite a bit. You know, and that was one of the sort of startling things about seeing who was actually pictured in these portraits, because, you know, when there was any sort of tie-in to the racial violence of that period, it was almost always through somebody who came down on the wrong side of that history. So, you know, Wilson, of course, you know, campaigned for president on these promises to forward civil rights. And then as soon as he got into office, he got rid of all people of African descent and replaced them with whites, refused to support an anti-lynching bill. you know, Howard Tasker Bliss appears a couple of times, and he, you know, really pandered to whites who feared arming Black soldiers and assigned Black troops to like this backbreaking menial labor rather than to combat. You know, and General Joseph John Joseph Pershing appears a couple of times. And, you know, he issued this memo to white troops saying, you know, don't have lunch with Black troops, don't shake their hands, you know, don't commend them too highly. And so, yeah, it was, you know, and then, you know, and when there was, you know, sort of like with the Gloria Swanson piece, you know, some kind of indication of, you know, what role people of color were playing in this country, it was always through this, you know, looking at white figures. And, you know, I do want to note that, you know, that the National Portrait Gallery does have early portraits of people of color in their collection. You know, prior to 1919, even, you know, many years prior to that, but they are fairly, you know, they're not common. And, you know, and in the particular year that I was looking, which was 1919, there were none. So right. I just want to make that clear.
Right, right. And there were none that were acquired during that year, right?
So it wasn't when they were acquired, but rather when the...
Oh, when they were created, right.
Created, yeah.
Right,
because the planning had just begun in 1919. So I know it's very confusing, but planning had just begun. So they weren't really acquiring any artworks until, you know, later decades.
Right. So that's an interesting thing that I think I might have missed. So even today, because you were not too long ago, artist in residence there, all of the... portraits for 1919 are of white sitters.
Yeah.
Right. So that's a characteristic that hadn't changed even yet, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. That leads me to a question for you, and I want to, so going back to that, the artist book, and in the artist book, and I had the pleasure of having a conversation, a Zoom conversation like this with Arlene Kaiser, who actually you introduced me to, and all of three of us have worked on Red Summer related projects. And she wrote an essay for the artist book. And in that essay, she writes, "For a white artist to engage in anti-portraiture," which is a term that she quotes from your statement, right? Anti-portraiture, "by disappearing valorized white historical subjects, opens a hopeful window onto a cultural project of refiguring US modernity," end quote. That's Arlene's quote. And so these concerns for me, I've recognized we've you know, talked about different projects over time. These concerns are evident in other works that you create. And I'm curious to know a little bit more about how and why these concerns emerged in your work.
So it, you know, I was born and raised in Billings, Montana, which is extremely white state. I went to public schools there. And, you know, I think like a lot of people in the United States, I was fed this narrative through the public education about our country being a land of opportunity and freedom and possibility and exceptionalism. You know, and of course that narrative is steeped in white perspective and serves to sort of gloss over, you know, little things like the genocide of the Native Americans that our country is founded on and the slavery that our country, you know, upheld as an institution. And, you know, so it's like a little embarrassing to admit, but it wasn't until I was actually a young adult that I realized that I was actually interested in history. I always thought that I wasn't interested in history. And when I look back on it, I'm like, oh, I wasn't interested in, you know, this history that I was being told was the case. And it wasn't until after graduate school. So in graduate school, I have been working on works that focused on the theme of conflict. And through that work, I came across, you know, texts on riots in general, and then specifically began researching the race riots. And it was through that, after graduate school, that I really realized like how little I knew about the story and how that story, like I said, had been sort of glossed over. And that just immediately piqued my interest because, you know, anytime a story is suppressed, that's the story that's probably going to tell you the most about what's going on. Right. So I just essentially like started this, you know, long process of self-education through, you know, through looking at that history. And that definitely is, you know, sort of what the Red Summer works are about. You know, I kind of had this idea that like, if I could just sort of wipe away the white narrative, you know, that maybe these other kinds of voices or stories would emerge. You know, a little like if you're at a dinner party and there's this like, you know, belligerent white guy who's like taking up all of the conversation and interrupting everybody who tries to get a word in edgewise, like just sort of escorting him out of the room and seeing what, you know, was left, like what kind of conversation ends up happening after you've escorted him out. And one of the really surprising things about that series is that, you know, I was expecting once the white sitters were removed that there would be this room for a new narrative to emerge, and that is not what ended up happening. You know, because there was nothing about the props or the surrounding environments themselves that spoke to the violence of that particular period. What the series did end up doing was sort of showing how those props and surrounding environments, you know, supported this idea of the identity of these folks as being valorous, as being worthy of remembrance, of celebration. You know, you have, you know, like the sword that's carried by Admiral William Soden Sims, you know, speaking to his, you know, sort of, you know, masculine prowess and militaristic influence. You have these like elaborate architectural details in the offices of these statesmen that, you know, essentially suggest that it's their God-given right to be in those spaces. So that was an interesting thing to come out, an unexpected and interesting thing to come out of that project, you know, thinking about how visual culture serves to uphold and promote and continue these kinds of power imbalances.
All right. One thing. That's great. Can I just add what I had a whole another sort of follow-up, but you answered a lot of it, but I do want to get one little piece of that follow-up, which is that, you know, just to, and I think it's helpful for people, is to, I think most people would sort of guess that Montana was maybe not as diverse as some of the other states, but before our talk today, I was looking up the last census, and I think while there are a couple of ethnicities that have actually more presence, African-American presence in Montana is below 1%. It's maybe like 0.5 or 0.6% of the population at the last census, maybe a little bit different today. And what is tied to this experience in your work, I thought I was also just interested in the idea that Montana was also a place that didn't really have activity in terms of slavery, even though, so at the time it would have been part of the Nebraska Territory, but again, that area was not an area that was, you know, very active in terms of slavery. And obviously for us, the American South is a place generally much more active in terms of slavery. So I wondered, in all of that, not so much is the degree to which you reference the way in which all of that experience would have been invisible to you. It's not even the idea that you would have necessarily developed a hostility towards others, but that you really talking about, you know, making visible something that had in a sense been invisible to you. And especially the way you described your early school experience and I just think that that's a, it's a, especially for me, I had such obviously a different experience growing up. And I think that's an important part of the conversation in thinking about our conversations across the boundary of race and the way in which we've been able to connect well in that regard.
Well, I
don't know if there's a real question there.
I have an answer to that non-question. And I'm going to say
good, really good, good, good.
I'll say it as quickly as possible because there is another question that I really want to ask you, and I realize that we're starting to run low on time. In response to what you were saying, it brings up, and I've actually never told this story because I'm very embarrassed about it, but in 1983, when I was 10 years old, the country voted whether to make Martin Luther King Day a national holiday. And so we had a conversation in my grade school about it. And I think I remember the grade school like letting us vote about whether we thought we should make it a national holiday. And so I came back home after school and told my mom, I voted no that we shouldn't have Martin Luther King Day because we don't have any Black people here and it doesn't have anything to do with me. And I will tell you, she gave me a dressing down that I will never forget. and basically made a very convincing argument about, how just by virtue of being in this country, we're all connected. And that talk has lasted with me to this day. And I think that like, it's my sort of vision then is a very similar argument to what we hear a lot today, which is like, well, slavery didn't have anything to do with me. You know, that was many years ago. And, and I'm not oppressing anybody. And it's not connected to anything that I'm doing. So, I think that it's really important to realize that we are all connected.
I'm going to ask the question. The question is erasure the only product or production of this repetition compulsion you both describe, or do you see some element of progressive reconciliation, even if it is failed or somehow impoverished? I'm reminded of psychotherapy and wonder to what extent that process is metaphor.
Casey, do you want to, or do you want me to? Yeah, either way.
I kind of see that as relevant to your Schools for the Color series. And one of the things that I particularly love about that series is how, in some cases, the school is still standing and you can see it, and in other cases, you've just blacked it out with a silhouette when the school doesn't appear. And there seems to be something reconstructive, even in placing those silhouettes back inside the landscape. And yet you're also maintaining this sense of mystery to it. You're not spelling out exactly what that school looked like. A lot of times it's just speculative. So I'm interested in your work in that kind of possibility of speculation and what kind of regenerative capacity that I have.
There's no doubt that that's absolutely right. And that side of my work is often in many ways the most complex, where Summer is fairly straightforward in terms of its concerns about racial violence against Black communities, the most part to be a hostile presence against Black communities, a sense of keeping African Americans out. And we know the whole history of separate but equal not being equal, and a whole range of different concerns that go with that. But having said that, and I've served on panels with residents that actually attended the segregated schools, and of course today we have still systems of segregated schools throughout this country. But one of the things that is also true And we see that in writing by people like Bell Hooks. And she writes about the fact that in her segregated Black school when she was a child, she knew and felt that her Black teachers had her best interest at heart. And she was one of that, she was of that generation that then moved to integrated schools and had the experience of being seen as being seen through hostile eyes by white teachers who and white peers who says, you know, quite emphatically that she would not recommend going back to segregation, but she really is describing the fact that it was a very complicated experience for her. Her Black teachers, when she was in those schools, knew her, knew the community, and I think that was probably generally true for both Black and white communities at one time that is no longer true today. So there's a degree to which we don't have that kind of community cohesion, regardless of whether the community is you know, homogeneous or heterogeneous in terms of the ethnic makeup. But I think that it is there. The schools project is filled with stories of schools. The school that I showed is a New Jersey school. It was the New Jersey Industrial and Manual Training School for Colored Youth. It was a 90-acre campus. Buildings are still standing. Some of the, you know, top Black intellectuals of the day would come through and give presentations. They sort of surreptitiously developed a classical education. They, you know, by the title, you know, you can sort of see that it was intended to be a vocational school, but quietly they introduced all kinds of curriculum that allowed students to go on to higher education. It was the only segregated boarding school in a northern state. And it consisted of about 12 buildings on 90 acres. So it was the size of a small college campus. I mean, it was a significant institution, and it had a significant role in the community. In fact, one of our former president, Dr. Vera King Farris, when I was working on this project at one point, she told me a story about remembering in as a child going to outings at Bordentown School or New Jersey Manual Training and Industrial, where there were all kinds of family events that were held and people from the broader Black community would often gather on that campus for various events, famous speakers coming through, et cetera. So these schools weren't only the result of, they were the result of hostility on the part of the white community towards the presence of Blacks in the schools. But at the same time, in many cases, Blacks built schools within our communities that serve well and serve students well as within the limits or confines that were possible. So I think that is one way in which that does intersect in that way. So I think you're really right to, you know, select that project as having that characteristic.
Well, and in the case of the Bordentown School that you're talking about, the irony of the end of it was that it was after Board of Education, like that the school ended up having to close down because everything needed to integrate.
Right, right. And to add to the sort of, you know, I mean, I do want to celebrate that school and say, you know, how wonderful it was. But one of the other things that has been unfortunate about it is that afterwards, after it closed and after it went through a couple of different iterations, it became a juvenile detention center. So, in essential, the school became a prison as part of the New Jersey, you know, prison system. So, correctional system. So, it's an unfortunate direction. I know there are people that are trying to transform that. I'm not sure where that process is right now.
Another question. Is the lack of mainstream information challenging when it comes to creating a more truthful or open narrative in your pieces?
Yes, often. I don't know, Wendel, do you want to answer that first? Or?
Well, yeah, and I agree, it's often, but it's also in some ways not always my goal as in terms of what I'm trying to do. I'm simply, in some cases, interested in pulling out the untold portion of the story and not necessarily being pulled into the notion this is a specific truth about this specific thing. It's just that the narratives have tended to be one-sided in one way, and that's very much the Red Summer case, and I hope over time to continue to build a within the project right now, there are some of the sites that are described through Black newspapers, some through white newspapers. And I would like to really create parallels for both of those, because that becomes an important way of revealing something about how we all experience things. And this is one of the, I think, great challenges, is the unwillingness to accept that the other Black community might experience something that the white community is very happy with in a different way, in a way that is painful, in a way that is harmful, in a way that is detrimental to the community. And so both of those things can coexist, and it's about recognizing when we're doing, you know, harm to others and not necessarily being concerned with an absolute truth.
Yeah, it reminds me of, you know, at Fordham right now, I'm in the process of developing a new course that'll be offered next year that I'm calling Visual Justice. And one of the things, inspirations for this course is comes from the Nigerian writer Chimamanda Adichie, who says that, you know, she talks about what she calls the danger of a single story. And so this idea of like bringing in several different stories, and those stories can be in conflict, they can be in confluence, but it sort of is like the, you know, the cumulative effect of all of those stories that helps shed light on things in situations in a more complicated and complex way.
Okay, a question specifically for Casey. Was the use of an image of an invisible man purposely ambiguous in terms of race?
In the Red Summer?
Yes.
That's a really interesting question I hadn't thought about. You know, I think that because I'm seeing the originals, I see the disappearance of that, of those figures as being like so white. You know, I really, like, even when I look at the quote unquote emptied out renditions that I've made, they just have whiteness all over them for me. So I guess, no, I wouldn't say that it was, it ended up, you know, I think that like when I first came up with the concept, I was hoping that, you know, like I sort of insinuated earlier, like I was hoping that it would, that the project would sort of invite in these new narratives. And I think instead it ended up, you know, really, really talking about whiteness and how it gets, you know, sort of repositioned within the existing structures of power that are, you know, and still in operation in this country.
Thank you.
Right.
Have other Absolutely. Artists
I think
influenced?
That's it. I mean, and
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Wendel.
I just wanted to add how I find that so remarkable and sort of disruptive about Casey's paintings, which is the way in which it does, you know, still feel like a container that is supposed to be filled with a white person as opposed to a person of color, right? Mm-hmm.
All right. Have other artists influenced or informed your approach or perspectives? I'm reminded of Fred Wilson and his groundbreaking exhibition, Mining the Museum.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think absolutely. I mean, I think his work is remarkable, and you know, I'm always reminded of the way in which that my first awareness of the way in which he was starting to, you know, work with artifacts was certainly influential, and the whole way in which material culture gradually played out in my work. I started very much with the project several decades ago that, you know, primarily focused around portraits and people. But within that, artifactual evidence became important. The landscape became important, and the landscape as a kind of repository for artifacts as well became very important in my work. And then that gradually moved directly towards that kind of representation. And of course, both of us have worked actually inside these kinds of items to historical societies, et cetera, in which I go and make photographs for my manifest series. But all of that, the Schools for the Card, Small Towns, Black Lives, Red Summer, is each one of them is about the artifacts and reframing them in some way.
Mm-hmm. Well, and even in your manifest series, you know, one of the things that I love about the way that you photographed those is that the object itself is often, part of it is in very sharp focus and then will sort of bleed into a much softer focus toward the back of the object or towards the sides of the objects, you know, in addition to being sort of floated against this black background. And there's something that ends up being, you know, it's a very different experience to look at your photographs of those objects than it is to stand in front of those actual objects, because you're almost sort of emphasizing parts of them and you're creating this intimacy with them that isn't necessarily as easily achieved when you're in a museum, you know, standing over a vitrine, looking at something from a distance.
Another question. When researching for Colored Schools projects, Wendel, how did you find a list of segregated Black schools? And is there a way to collect a list of Black independent schools that exist today?
Right. So it depends on where. So there are different organizations that have worked on the preservation and the gathering of information. I actually started encountering them as I was working on Small Towns, Black Lives, because all throughout Southern New Jersey, there were these remnants of Black schools. There was, you know, one in Whitesboro, there's one in Atlantic City, there's one in Swedesboro, and all of the, and I just, as I was working on these projects, people that I was coming to do a portrait of wanted to talk about the history of the school that was in their community. So it became a connection to telling the story of the community. And so then I began to, you know, expand from there. Now, most of those were done in the majority of them were done sort of around 2006 or seven, although some of them are later than that. And I was using, you know, internet searches to look for newspaper articles about schools as they were being talked about in various, once I started to define the area that I wanted to work in. So I had a, you know, Google search already to run all the time about, you know, school, segregated school or colored school or Negro school in Indiana. And then anytime that would come up, I would have that information and then I would pursue that information. In many cases though, as I got to know people connected to a school, they gave me information about other schools. So a lot of that information came from other people. There's a big project that, but since then, many people have worked on documentaries. There's a documentary on the Bordentown School. There's a documentary on and I can't remember, there's a school in Ohio, there's a new sort of a more recent documentary on the history of the school in Ohio, because many of the people that attended those schools were still living. And there is the Rosenwald schools, the whole network of schools that were constructed for Black communities all throughout the South. Rosenwald schools are only essentially in the South, and they actually have, I think, an annual conference, and they have a whole organization associated with the preservation of those schools all throughout the South. But in the North, I don't know of a single organization dedicated to, because they came about in different ways. Some of them are still active today as schools. They just are not, you know, legally segregated, but.
There are no more questions, but I would like to possibly end with a statement that was an observation.
Okay.
And this was from Professor Rubenstein. He felt that monuments tied you both together, your artwork together, and in Casey's case, her work can be understood in the context of the monument removal controversy that's been going on today. And Wendel, these sites should be monumentalized, but are not.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's really an important part, and certainly it's important to recognize, while the conversation has been going on for a while, that Casey was working on this idea going back. What was it? You started that residency in 2016, so in a sense, just before so many of the more recent events that have really spread around the country in terms of that conversation about removal. Casey, do you have any final questions?
No, I really love that, that I feel like that's a great statement to end on, because it, within that statement are all kinds of questions about how we value, whom we value.
So I just once again want to say how much I appreciate the work that Casey has been doing, and the connection that we first met. She was curating an exhibition and learned about my work, and then invited me to exhibit work at Fordham. And since then, we've had lots of conversations and, remarkable moments in which we start talking about our next project. And it turns out that our next projects are similar or interwoven in some way. And so I just have just been very interested in, appreciative of way. And it makes me sort of return to Arlene's comment about the way in which she, engaged with these ideas. And that was what brought me to, I knew that, she had grown up in Montana and in rural, I think when you say Billings, that's probably the closest town, right? I mean, exactly. In a rural setting. And I've always grown up in urban and suburban settings. And so, the opportunity for us as artists across racial, ethnic boundaries and gender and sort of foundational experiences in terms of rural and urban settings, all of those things, winding up as a finding some intersection point has, I think, just been very fruitful in terms of being able to show work and talk about how we came to these ideas from these different, places. So I just really appreciate the willingness to participate in these conversations. So I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to Denise for so ably handling all of our questions. I want to say thank you to Lisa Dean Honaker for the introductions and bringing us together. We've already gone over by a little bit. And thanks to all the folks that stayed with us to the very end. I see quite a few people have remained with us all the way through. So I really appreciate that everybody was able to attend, and just I really appreciate the willingness to come in and listen to our conversation. So thank you to everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.